Welcome to the 11th and final episode in a Legendarium series about the life and reign of Edward Longshanks. In part 11, Keep the Vow, we will talk about how King Edward's final years were marred not only by family discord, but a renewed rebellion in Scotland. For several years, Scotland had been divided between an English occupation in the southeast of the country and Scottish rebels who controlled the rest. That changed in July 1304 when King Edward I laid siege to Stirling Castle. For 3 months, Edward Longshanks battered the castle with trebuchets he brought north at great expense. Finally, the Scots agreed to surrender, but Edward rejected their offer. He just set up a new trebuchet called the Warwolf, and he wanted to see its fangs at work. The Scots endured another terrifying day of bombardment before Edward allowed them to surrender. Most of the Scot nobles made peace with Edward Longshanks, even Robert the Bruce. For a time, John Comyn the Red led the desperate and flagging resistance to English rule. Yet, what of William Wallace, the victor of Stirling Bridge? For a time, he traveled abroad seeking allies, and at some point he returned home, leading a small band of rebel outlaws. His career ended in the summer of 1305, when Scots loyal to Edward Longshanks captured him. There is one thing that the film did get right. William Wallace's death was horrific. On August 1305, Edward's men dragged Wallace through the streets, unclothed behind a horse-drawn cart. His executioners at Smithfield, outside London, hung Wallace from a noose but released him while he still lived. Next, they yelled at him, opened his abdomen, and removed his entrails, burning them on the wooden platform as Wallace died. It is unlikely Wallace could scream freedom after being disemboweled, but his executioners did indeed cut his head off. They then dipped it in tar and placed it on a pike atop London Bridge. It would surprise few to learn that Edward's temper grew more violent in his old age. His beloved wife, Margaret of France, did everything she could to shield her young ones from their father's wrath. Yet events beyond the royal family worsened Edward's mood. On February 10th, 1306, before the high altar of Greyfriars Kirk in Scotland, the two surviving claimants for the Scottish throne quarreled. The quarrel ended with Robert the Bruce murdering John Comyn the Red in a church. 5 weeks later, rebel Scottish clergy pardoned Robert the Bruce for his terrible sacrilege and crowned him Robert the First, King of Scots at Scone, mostly because they had no other candidate. To avenge Comyn's murder and punish the rebellious Bruce, Edward Longshanks sent an army north. On June 19th, at the Battle of Methven Park, the English took Bruce and his army by surprise. Bruce barely escaped with his life and went into hiding as an outlaw. When the news reached Edward that Bruce had escaped, he burst into a violent fury and resolved to finish matter with the Scots once and for all. He ordered his army to muster at Carlisle. Still vigorous in mind, the king's body was wearing out and he could ride no longer. Carried north by horse litter, he made his headquarters at Lanercost Priory near Carlisle. From there, his armies brought fire and the sword to Scotland. Meanwhile, there had been a quarrel between the king and his son and heir, the future Edward II, over the latter's obsession with his favorite Piers Gaveston. Ironically, Longshanks assigned Gaveston to Edward's household in the hope that the courageous and able Piers would inspire his son to great deeds. Instead, the young Edward became preoccupied with Gaveston and corrupted him by showering him with royal favors. When the younger Edward asked his father to give Gaveston the title of Count of Ponthieu, the old king turned on his son and seized him by the hair, calling him whoreson misbegotten boy. Edward Longshanks ripped handfuls of his son's hair out and even claimed out loud that his wife must have given herself to another man because young Edward could not possibly be his son. And instead of favoring Gaveston, Edward I ordered him exiled. By then, Edward Longshanks suffered badly from dysentery, and many anticipated his end would come soon. A supposed prophecy of Merlin began circulating. It held that after Longshanks' death, the Scots and the Welsh would unite and have things as they pleased. Suddenly, Bruce returned from hiding and appeared to make Merlin's prophecy come true. On May 10th, he defeated English forces at the Battle of Loudon Hill with a small band of devoted retainers. A defiant Longshanks decided that he must take the field again. He mounted his war horse and led his army north, but he could only ride 2 miles a day. When he reached the village of Burr-on-Sands, not far from Carlisle, he had to take to his bed. It was said that he realized doomsday neared for him, and he sent word to his son to have his embalmed body carried with the army into Scotland. Even in death, he could still lead his men. His son would not carry out his suggestion. About noon on July 7, 1307, when his servants came to lift him up so that he could eat, Edward Longshanks died in their arms. He was 68 years old. His body went to London, and mourners interred him in Westminster Abbey in October in a plain gray marble tomb. Craftsmen carved an inscription reading, "Here is Edward I, Hammer of the Scots, 1308. Keep the vow." Edward had sworn revenge upon Robert the Bruce, and his final wish was to see the rebel pay for his betrayal. And the last phrase in the inscription referenced Edward's cry for revenge. And while he did indeed become Hammer of the Scots, in the end, the Scottish anvil wore down the hammer. Even as Edward Longshanks died, Robert the Bruce consolidated control of northern Scotland. Edward's son, now Edward II, would not prove to be his father's, or for that matter, the Bruce's equal in any way. In an early sign of trouble, he recalled his favorite Piers Gaveston from exile, the first of many blunders which would ultimately cost him his crown and his life. Edward Longshanks, who became a strong and terrible king because of his weak father, had begat a weakling son who would lead England into disaster after Longshanks worked so hard to make England a mighty power. That wraps things up for this episode of The Legendarium. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, press like. If you want to see more, press subscribe. And if you've got anything to say, let me know in the comments section. Thanks again for joining me, and I hope that you have a great rest of the day.